departments. We must also commend the heroic work of our healthcare system and our healthcare workers. There will never be adequate words to thank them, as well as our first responders and essential workers who have been sacrificing on behalf of every resident in our city. We've begun to flatten the curve of Chicago's COVID-19 cases. However, as I said before, we must never confuse promising gains with outright success. We are not at the point where we can begin reopening our city yet. The light at the end of the tunnel is absolutely there, but it's still just a glimmer, and we still have a long way to go before we can safely return to the way things were before. We will get there, but we have to do it in a way we've always done it from the very beginning of this pandemic, to be guided by the data and the science, our public health guidance, period. To do otherwise would be reckless, irresponsible, and of course, deadly. And I will not allow that to happen in this city. That's why today I'm proud to be joining our Public Health Commissioner, Dr. Allison Arwady, and others here to announce the Protecting Chicago framework, specifically designed for Chicago's residents and businesses and encompassing a clear, data-driven, five-phase process. This framework was created to enhance Governor Pritzker's outline for reopening our state and tailored to our unique environment here in Chicago, and build on the governor's leadership across Illinois through this crisis. We have been working on these plans for weeks, but we agreed that the state, of course, should go first, and then we would work to harmonize our plans with those laid out by the state. Protecting Chicago framework is more than just a roadmap for city leadership. It's about protecting all of our residents and businesses, as well as protecting the future of our city as we move through this crisis and lay the foundation for the recovery that must and will follow. This also represents a framework for the dialogue we'll be having with our residents and businesses throughout our reopening process, a process of dialogue that's been ongoing throughout. The first phase of protecting Chicago follows the strict guidelines of staying at home and maintaining safe physical distance from anyone who you do not live with. Phase two does the same. However, while also seeing us flatten the curve of Chicago's COVID-19 cases, and we believe that we are in phase two now. And its rules are the ones we all know well. Only go out for essential activities, brief walks near your home, and when you go out, wear a face cover and practice safe social distancing. Following this phase, when the science and the data allows, we'll move to phase three, which will be a limited reopening. This includes non-essential workers returning to their jobs in a phased manner, and select businesses, nonprofits, and city entities opening if they can demonstrate a plan for appropriate protections for employees and customers. This phase also allows for a limited reopening of some public amenities and small non-business social gatherings limited to 10 people or fewer. However, make no mistake, this phase still has us wearing face coverings and physically distancing when meeting others. It also has those of you who are sick continuing to stay home. And this guidance that even if you're a little bit sick, that you must stay home will continue for the foreseeable future. Those that are a member of a vulnerable population will also be advised to continue to stay home. And those you've come into contact, and if you've come into contact with someone who has COVID-19, continuing to stay home, as well as immediately contacting your healthcare provider if you have COVID-19 symptoms. Phase four. Phase four sees us reopening a little further, with additional businesses coming back online, more restrictions being lifted, and additional reopening of public amenities. with all residents continuing to wear face coverings and physically distancing, and vulnerable populations continuing to shelter in place. Finally, after all the appropriate measures are met, we will reach phase five, our fifth star, which is a near complete reopening of our city. That means businesses are opening up, workers returning to their jobs so long as they're staying healthy, and most activities and events resuming, though possibly with some caveats. This phase will be supported with workplace screenings and tests. I want to pause for a moment to take a special note about our businesses. What I want is for our city to come out of this crisis stronger and more resilient than we've ever been. I want our recovery to stand as a model for other cities around the world. I want nothing less than for our efforts over the coming months to truly warrant a fifth star on our flag. However, we are facing an urgent crisis with scores of businesses struggling to survive, particularly our small and micro businesses, many of whom are truly hanging on by a thread. Based on the numbers we are seeing, if these businesses don't open soon, many will be forced to close their doors entirely. And so, to our businesses, I want you to know that we're doing everything we can to keep that from happening, and we'll continue to do so throughout every phase of this crisis. Of course, we have to be led by the data and science, and only opening additional businesses when we can do so safely. And the question of safety is one that we will need to continue to be in dialogue with a variety of businesses by type, sector, size, and that will also influence and inform our public policy. In a moment, Dr. Arwady will be offering details on the specific metrics we'll need to see in order to move from phase two, where we are now, to the next phase of our reopening. But they really boil down to answering four key questions. One, is there a decrease in the rate the disease is spreading? Critically important. We've seen progress, but not a decrease yet. Do we have testing and contact tracing available to track the disease and limit its spread? Are there enough systems, support systems in place for our vulnerable populations? And last, can our healthcare system handle a potential case surge? If the answer is no to any of these, then we simply cannot and will not move to the next phase. We will also, if necessary, take a step back if that's where the data leads us. Over the next several weeks, we'll be providing further details for businesses and public amenities related to each phase of our reopening based on the continued dialogue with each sector in our city. And to that point, as I mentioned earlier, protecting Chicago is more than just a framework for city leadership. It's also a framework for continued dialogue. Protecting Chicago itself was created in partnership with community and industry working groups from across our city. We want this process to continue to be an important and rigorous dialogue between residents, businesses, and local organizations. One size does not fit all. As I said to the alderman earlier today, we need to hear from all of Chicago in order to develop the best ways to reopen safely and move our city forward. Toward that end, we've created an online survey to hear from residents directly on the ways you can best support our reopening. Your responses will shape our decisions on where we need to place greater emphasis and how we can make our reopening as smooth and supportive as possible. And I encourage Chicagoans to fill out this survey by visiting our city's COVID website, chicago.gov/coronavirus. The survey is simple, it is short, and it is anonymous. These next steps will be important and encouraging, but we can't get ahead of ourselves. This is a framework we'll need to operate in until we have a vaccine for COVID-19. And regardless of what you may be hearing elsewhere, the truth is we do not know right now when a vaccine will be available. All of us, of course, want it to come as soon as possible. But at this point, we don't anticipate having one until sometime in 2021. And I'm going to say that again. We don't know when it's coming. We hope it's sometime in 2021, but it's not here yet. Until then, the structure of our lives will continue to be based on how we can safely move around. How do we maintain social distance, even as we gradually open up and come back together? How do we take care of and safeguard our most vulnerable residents? Critical questions for us to be able to answer. All that means is continuing our rules related to face coverings, hand washing and sanitizing, and physical distancing. I take very seriously my responsibility to keep our residents safe every day in any way that I can. And I want to thank the residents for everything that you've done to stay home and to save lives. It's been critically important. It's made all the difference in the progress that we've made in the city, but we have to maintain that vigilance and diligence in making sure that we are continuing to follow the public health guidelines. I also want to thank the countless individuals and organizations who've really stepped up in remarkable ways for helping their fellow Chicagoans in this time of great need everywhere. As hard as it's been, we are getting through this. But we must continue to work hard and be diligent. This is truly an experience like none we've ever seen before. And we have to do it together as one city in a recovery that will make all of us stronger and more resilient and more inclusive than we've ever been. And at this point, I'd like to invite Dr. Arwady to the podium to provide details on the health metrics that will be guiding our progress forward. Doctor?
Thank you very much, Mayor. So it's my job to give you a first look at the specific public health data we'll be using as Together We Protect Chicago. My team of epidemiologists or data scientists at the Chicago Department of Public Health track these and many other metrics every day. And we've chosen some of the most important indicators that will let us know that it is safe to move forward as a city. I want to be clear that these indicators are in no way in conflict with the broader state framework, but they allow us to follow our local outbreak in much more detail and, as always, direct resources to where they are most needed. We have defined seven indicators that, in combination, will let us follow cases, hospital capacity, testing capacity, response capacity. We have to be sure that as a city, we are making progress in all of these areas. We are all so anxious to get as many people back to work as quickly and safely as we can, and to get us all back to our new normal. Following this data over time will let us do this in a data-driven way and will let us protect Chicago. I'll give you a quick sense of where we are on each of them. The details are meant, as the mayor said, to guide the next stage of our transmission from stay at home to cautiously open. You'll get a sense of where we've made the most progress based on where those yellow stars are. The stars further to the right signal the ones that we're already further along on. We want to be absolutely transparent about the local information that we're using to make these decisions. So I'll be talking in more detail about all of these indicators on the Facebook Live that I do at 11 every day, and we'll be posting on the website details about each indicator with graphs that you'll be able to track over time to see how we're doing in each of these areas. I want to be clear that the stars may move at a slightly different pace, but fundamentally, we need to be able to say yes. Are the cases going down? Yes. Can our hospitals handle the number of people who are seriously ill with COVID-19? Yes. Are we testing enough as a city? Yes. And are we building up our response capacity to be able to meet the demands and protect Chicago, not just right now, but all the way through recovery? Yes. Let's look at them quickly. The first two indicators have to do with the basic question of whether cases are going down. As of today, we have 28,567 lab-confirmed cases in Chicago residents. We have 1,206 deaths in Chicago residents. We are adding cases every day, 999 cases just since yesterday. We need to see that rate of increase not just flatten, but be on the decline. But we also need to potentially correct that for the increase in testing that you've seen. And so, for example, the state chose to call out a 20% positivity rate as sort of a sign of making progress on cases. Currently, here in Chicago, we're at approximately a 26% positivity rate. But I'll tell you in a minute how we want to get at that amount of progress. But also, we don't just want to follow the overall cases. The second indicator gets at cases by looking at the severe outcomes. So that's the people who need to be hospitalized, need to be in the ICU, need to be on a ventilator, or unfortunately die. Because in those settings, we've had very good testing from very early on. So we don't have this problem of the change in testing. We are seeing flattening and just the beginnings of decline in a lot of these. We want to see these declines for all of the time-based indicators on an average over 14 days so that we know we are safely making progress. The third really gets at hospital capacity. And here, we put this right into our Chicago context. So at the state level, they talked about making sure that we had at least a 14% surge capacity. But that can be a little complicated to define because here in Chicago, our hospitals have already surged a lot to meet the demand, particularly in the ICU. And so every day we do follow. We know that, for example, right now about 20% of the ICU beds are available in Chicago. But what we wanted to do was turn this into something that we can follow and everybody can understand over time. And so we've set some pretty specific goals. We've said, for example, that our hospital beds outside the ICU, we don't want to see more than 1,800 COVID patients needing non-ICU beds in Chicago hospitals. Right now, we're at a little bit under 1,200 on that, so we're doing okay. We right now have 480 patients in the ICU in Chicago hospitals. We really can't handle more than about 600 COVID patients across our ICUs. We have 321 patients, COVID patients on ventilators. We can't handle more than about 450. And so setting these concrete numbers helps us understand that as we open, as we potentially see some small increase in cases, we don't run the risk of overwhelming our healthcare system. The next indicators are all about testing capacity. So again here, the state has said we need to make sure that we can test across a range of different groups. Obviously, we agree with that and we're working towards that. But we wanted to set some more specific goals. And so specifically for testing capacity, we're really saying, you know, by the end of the month, our goal is to be able to test at least 5% of Chicago residents every month. That works out to us being able to do 4,500 tests a day here in Chicago. We're at about 3,000 tests a day here in Chicago, so we're hoping to grow that by about 50% just over the next few weeks. And certainly, as more federal testing resources have come through the state and the state's been partnering to push testing resources in, we've seen that grow. We've got other plans to grow that. But we feel that that indicator gives us a place for this next stage to feel confident that we're doing enough testing. But we're not just using that number. We're looking again at this percent positivity rate. And that has to do with how many tests are positive divided by how many tests are you doing overall. And really, if I was going to choose one factor, this is the one that helps you know how you're doing as a city, as a state, as a country. The way you see your percent positivity come down is either by bringing down that top number, having fewer new cases, or by increasing that bottom number, doing more testing. So where we have a percent positivity that is high, we need to do more testing as we see the cases come down. And so we're defining, we actually want to set some different goals for the tests that we do in our congregate settings, meaning our nursing homes, potentially in the jail, in our homeless shelters, where we actually are expecting to find some more cases, and we want to set a slightly lower goal for a percent positivity that we're seeing in the community. These are not final goals, but we wanted to set, you know, some idea of where we're really hoping to be as we move into the next phase. Syndromic surveillance is a way at understanding what cases are looking like as people come into the emergency department without needing to test them. It helps us put a finer point on case rate, hospital capacity, and testing, and so that's another one that fits in. And then finally, our capacity for response, case investigation, and contact tracing. We already are growing this capacity, but we want to make sure we have an expanded system in place, and we're doing all kinds of work to grow that over the next few weeks to make sure that while we track these metrics, we of course are responding. So we will see these move at different levels, at different points over time. The big buckets, we are confident that we will see the movement that we need to, as long as people through the month of May continue to abide by the stay-at-home order. That is what has flattened the curve for us so far. That most fundamentally will get us on the other side and going down. We'll watch the hospital capacity, we'll build the testing capacity, and we'll build our response capacity. All of these together, we feel confident that we will be able to move ahead, not just our next step, but throughout this response. Our goal is to use data to protect Chicago and get us all back to our new normal. And with that, I will bring up Samir Mayakar.
Thank you, Doctor, and good afternoon, everybody. I'm here to talk about engagement. As you heard from the mayor, our process for reopening the city is one that involves dialogue and communication. You've just heard from Dr. Arwady about the health guidelines that we need to move to the next phase. But what's on probably a lot of your minds is what will happen within each phase? What will life look like? And per that end, we've partnered with industry, with community organizations, and with organized labor to help us develop detailed playbooks of guidelines within each phase. Now, as a former small business founder, I know that we cannot take a one-size-fits-all approach to our industry. We need to listen to the nuanced needs of various types of businesses. And that's why we've launched 10 industry reopening groups. Those groups are going to focus on safe interactions for workers and for customers. They're going to think through the details about protective gear, about hygiene standards, about capacity constraints. And in the coming weeks, you will see guidelines that are very detailed in terms of what will the next phase, the cautiously reopened phase, look like. Finally, in addition to engaging industry, we want to hear from you. And that's why the mayor has requested that you all, as Chicago residents, take our survey. And as she mentioned, you can visit chicago.gov/coronavirus. We truly hope you'll fill out our reopening survey because we want to hear from you. And with that, I'd like to turn it over to one of the members of our industry working groups who's been a valued partner of ours here in City Hall, and that is Sam Toya with the Illinois Restaurant Association.
Thank you, Samir. I'd like to thank Mayor Lightfoot for her steadfast leadership throughout the ongoing crisis. I always say communication and education is the key to success. Mayor Lightfoot and her team are always communicating and educating, and they also want to be educated and communicated back with. We really appreciate that. As you all have heard, the City of Chicago is taking a thoughtful approach to reopening our economy by assembling experts from all industries to offer recommendations and best practices. These working groups represents the breadth and diversity of Chicago's business community and the many individuals we employ. I'm honored to lead the working team focused on the food and beverage sector. And let me go deep on that. So we got restaurateurs and beverage sector people from the south side, the west side, the southwest side, the northwest side, north side. We have a great working group. And we are offering our thoughts and feedback on the state's plan, which we believe underestimates our ability to operate safely. On a day-to-day basis, restaurateurs are focused on the health and safety of our customers and our team members. This isn't new to us. Even before the pandemic, restaurant operators have been held to the highest health standards. Restaurants are the cornerstones of our 77 communities here in the culinary capital of the United States. Under Mayor Lightfoot's leadership and with this joint effort between civic, business, and community stakeholders, we look forward to getting back to work safely. Thank you.
And now we're happy to get myself back together. Happy to take your questions.
Thank you, Mayor.
Sure.
This plan, like the governor's plan, does not have dates like we have seen with some other states. Mm-hmm. What about that? Folks are anxious to see, okay, when will I go to my favorite restaurant? When will my child go to summer camp? Why no dates associated with the plan?
Well, that's very easy because we have to be guided by the science and the data. And we can't predict and put a stake in a particular date to say this is going to happen this way or that way. This virus has been unpredictable really from the very beginning. You recall back in March, we really were worried greatly that we were going to see a huge spike in cases that would overrun our healthcare system. Luckily, that didn't happen. Even in the last 2 weeks, we've seen a lot of fluidity in what we're seeing in the data. So we could put a date out, but it would be completely arbitrary, and it wouldn't be governed by the science and the data. We have to be led by what the public health experts are telling us. And so we believe that we have set out a framework that is workable, that makes sense, that is data-driven. But when the precise dates are, when we hit those metrics and those milestones, we'll only know when we get there.
Can you tell us if you consulted with the governor? Did you show him your plan? Did you get feedback from the governor? How have those discussions gone? When's the last time you spoke? Not just myself, Dana Kozlov is asking that as well.
I spoke with the governor earlier today. We talk virtually every day. He read me into at a high level what their plans were. Obviously, we now have had the opportunity to see it in detail. This is something that both of us, meaning the state and the city, have been working on for weeks. And so we talked several times about a framework, talked about phasing. We talked about gradual reopening. So, yeah, those conversations have been taking place for some time.
There are some discrepancies, including differences, mm-hmm. Between the two plans, positivity rate being one of them. Mm-hmm. We've asked Dr. Ezike about that. She told her answer is those congregate settings, which others have also decided to take those out. Indiana takes it out as well. Mm-hmm. But she has answered that question before, and I'm not quoting word for word, but those folks that work in the nursing homes or work in the jails live in the community and therefore go to grocery stores and wherever. So she feels they should be part of that positivity rate. But I'm hearing a different answer from all of you today.
Yeah, I don't think that's quite true. I'm going to invite Dr. Arati up to answer the specifics. But look, if you read the fine detail of the governor's plan, and I have, and probably many of you have as well, you see that it allows for specific cities and regions to come up with region-specific plans. Obviously, the governor's plan is one that covers the entirety of the state, but there's a lot of differences between, you know, Chicago and Cairo, from us to Peoria and Champaign-Urbana. So I think the beauty of the governor's plan is it allows us to use local specific data to dig down into particulars on how we're going to protect the city of Chicago based upon the data that's different here than it is in other parts of the state. It would be impossible to have a one-size-fits-all plan, and we read the governor's plan as giving us the flexibility to offer up specific local guidance, and that's what we're attempting to do today. But do you want to?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
So I'll just add briefly, again, no significant conflict here, but it really has to do